Hello, everybody. It's Dr. Nick here with another exciting episode of the Hospitality Spirit Podcast. I am really excited today to be joined by Danny O'Leary. As a sports and entertainment marketing trailblazer, brand architect, entrepreneur, and business strategist, Danny's goal is to deliver brand and property solutions that drive sales, preference, awareness, and sustainable return on investments and objectives. He draws from his experience advising some of the world's most powerful sports properties and blue chip brands to engineer and manufacture omni-channel marketing platforms, dynamic campaigns, and turnkey corporate sponsorship blueprints. In the last 15 years, Danny has grown into an accomplished business development and integrated marketing professional, having worked for some of the industry's leading and award-winning agencies and thought leaders. This experience and knowledge prepared him to lead the United States Polo Association's marketing and corporate partnership interests. While there, he led a number of USPA marketing and business milestones, including an enhanced broadcast and digital distribution approach that would ultimately lay the foundation for USPA's Polo Network, a new refined adrenaline brand strategy, and establish new and future corporate and strategic marketing relationships. He also established and enhanced a measurable social media presence, more impactful PR and communication outreach, and developed a successful foundation for its national sponsorship program. In 2018, Danny founded Ladere Partners, a parent organization that manages a portfolio of sports marketing, event properties, and humanitarian businesses that emulate the founder's passion for sports, volunteering, and entrepreneurism. Danny, thanks for being on the podcast today.
Excited to be here, Nick.
So Danny, there's a lot we can dive into. You have what I would consider an extensive background in sports and entertainment, but you and I first crossed paths just this year in your role as managing director of one of the oldest and most prestigious polo clubs in America, the Oakbrook Polo Club. DePaul University became a strategic partner for you. I've been very fortunate to attend several matches this year. It's been a great time, great experience. And I'd like to actually start there if we could and really talk about what your role is as managing director, maybe a little bit about the history of the Oakbrook Polo Club and really its role in Chicagoland as a premier sports experience.
Sure.
So managing director, what does that mean?
Managing director is, it's pretty much the person who does it all from managing the execution of our events, you know, our sponsorship programs and execution, our magazine, managing the team, both on and off the field, tournament development, overseas play, if and when we do decide to play overseas and other tournaments. So there's a lot that goes on. Local management, because we operate on public land and we are partners with the Village of Oak Brook, there is a lot of municipality relations in order to execute this since we operate on public land. So it's everything, I'm just short of president, if you will. Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I've really been amazed by is the loyal following and the holistic experience that is really like no other sporting event I've really attended when I attend a polo event at Oakbrook Polo Club. And I think a lot of that stems from the rich history that this particular polo club has. Can you talk a little bit about Oakbrook Polo Club and its history and where it sits today and kind of the larger landscape of polo in the U.S.?
Yeah, sure. And you kind of have to even go back a little bit further than that because, polo's history is considered one of the oldest team sports, getting back to, Calcutta, which is the oldest polo club in the entire world, and having used polo as a form of developing horsemen's skills for cavalry officers. Obviously, that was extended and into Europe, which also added a tradition, including the polo shirts as well as the white pants. And the United States also adopted polo as the same military sport used to teach their cavalry officers horsemanship skills. As the sport itself and how it's played, you know, reflects a lot of what a cavalry officer might experience during war. Mm-hmm. Obviously, cavalries aren't around anymore. Technology is obviously excluded that, but you know, cavalries did exist in World War One. Paul Butler, who was the founder of the Oakbrook Polo Club in 1922, provided many of the horses that were in the United States military at that time. Chicago in itself has a very, very deep history in our sport. A lot of it goes unnoticed. You can actually go back to 1879, where it's the first recorded polo match in Washington Park on the south side of Chicago. Wow. And since then, it actually has flourished. Chicago and Oakbrook specifically used to be the epicenter of professional polo for 50 years. The United States Polo Association was headquartered here. You have two prominent female polo players, which were first recognized as members of the USPA and competed against the men. One of them actually dressed up as a male and competed against, as you know, she was excluded from back to the day, and that was Sue Sunny Hale. So that's a very respected and Hall of Famer within the United States Polo Association. Oakbrook Polo Team itself has 6 U.S. Open Championship titles to its name, which I think is the third most of all the professional sports within Chicago. We are the third oldest, third or fourth oldest, I believe, sports organization still in operation today. So we have a lot of history. I mean, up and down the lakeshore and to the west of us, a lot of prominent figures within Chicago that we are all familiar with, the McCormicks, the Wrigleys, the Armour family, all have been big polo families at the end of the day. big rivalries between us and Milwaukee and the Uline family, which is a very well-known name up there for being one of the three founders of the Milwaukee Brewers. Mm-hmm. So a lot of great history has come through here in Chicago. Many big tournaments. You know, we've had 30 countries have come through here to play, many of whom were at that one point military officers that had come out to play and can play competitively. This is obviously back in the 1920s and 30s and 40s. but Oakbrook's really name to fame was Paul Butler rescuing the sport of polo back in about 1947, I want to say 1948, after World War II, where some of the polo clubs out on the East Coast had closed down. Paul Butler put the money towards bringing Oakbrook to be the epicenter of professional polo in the United States. Wow. And as a result of that, it was for about 50 years. The U.S. Polo Championships were held here for 24 straight years, which is the longest ever in one location. A lot of the people that you see that are Hall of Famers within the USPA had gotten their start or played here on Oakbrook Polo Club. So there's a deep and profound history. One of the biggest polo matches ever recorded in the United States was actually in Owensia Polo Club, which is a country club and golf course, now used to be a polo club, up on the North Shore, where about 40,000 people over a weekend attended the best players on the East Coast and West Coast as they competed over the course of, I think, a weekend. And it was back in 1937, which was the year, I think, of the last World's Fair that was held here in Chicago. So
interesting.
Lots to hang our hat on up here. I could go on and on and on.
So one of the things I really love about going to polo matches, and to be completely transparent, this is something that was not on my radar before this year. I grew up on the East Coast and I grew up around sport and I love sport, but because I really wasn't introduced to polo at an early age, it wasn't on my radar. But one of the things I love about going to matches is right at the beginning of the match, there's always a time where they kind of explain the rules of the road, if you will, because there's a lot of people that are going to these matches that maybe are attending for the first time. It's starting to become commonplace for them. For those listening right now that maybe aren't familiar with polo, can you just kind of summarize just briefly, I don't want to go into deep into the rules, but just kind of the format. It's divided into a series of chukkas, and it's four players per side. For those that aren't familiar.
We play on the largest pitch in sports. So we play on 300 by about 160 yards. So really? That's okay. Nine football fields to create some relevancy with other sports. It is 4-on-4 players, with the numbers 1 through 4. Each number represents a different position on the field. Either that individual is more of an offensive player or a defensive player.
Similar to like what you'd see in rugby.
Yeah. The number three position or number three player is typically the best player on the team and is more of an offensive player. So every time you see breakaway shots and things like that where you're going to 30, 35 miles per hour, you're typically seeing, your number three guy out there. That's why when you see a lot of, polo jerseys that are sold as merchandise, they always have the number three on it, as that's identified as the best player on the team. As you mentioned, each period is called a chukker. Each chukker is about 7.5 minutes in length. At most, there are 6 chukkers in a polo match, 3 and then halftime or divot stomp, as we call it, which the actual spectators can go out and replace the divots that the horses make on the field, which is very important to have spectators contribute to the grooming and maintenance of our field. And those chukkers can vary between, as few as 3 to 4 chuckers as well, depending upon the skill level and the horse availability. Mm-hmm. We're playing at Oakbrook 12-go polo, which is considered medium-go polo. So we do have 3 professionals on the field as well as an amateur patron. Polo is commonly a pro-am type sport, mm-hmm. where there is the amateur or sponsor that is also playing alongside the patrons, who essentially is the financier of the team at the end of the day. Each team that we are competing against, usually you have 1 horse per chucker. So on our level, each person pretty much has 6 to 8 horses per player. So you're looking at between 24 and 32 ponies per team.
Which is quite remarkable, because you'll be sitting there. I mean, the last couple of matches I've been to, it's been 90, 95, close to 100 degrees. And these horses, as you said, are going 35 miles an hour, carrying the weight of a player. And so it's not uncommon for right in the middle of a chukker for them to just switch out the horse.
Yes.
Because these are horses that are at peak performance. They're trained for this, but the endurance is a huge factor in that.
Correct. And it's very much like hockey. When you say that, the players can remount at any time, they have a very good sense as to when their horses might get winded. They can remount at any time on either end of the field, very similar to changing the line in hockey.
Sure.
And you can do that anytime during match play.
That's very, very cool. And one of the things that is, I don't know if it's unique to Oakbrook Polo Club or this region, but there's almost a competition structure. You've got the Butler Cup going on. So there's a tournament built into the season, or how does that work?
Yeah. So specifically in Chicago, Oakbrook is part of a polo network called the Chicago Polo Association. So we are one of 7 USPA clubs in the Chicagoland and Western Suburb area, which includes up to 17 polo facilities, not necessarily fields, but also arenas as well. Mm-hmm. So within that network, we have everything from 0-goal polo to all the way up to 12-goal being played. So there are anywhere between 2 to 3 tournaments going on simultaneously alongside practice leagues and things like that, that might be occurring for new students and amateurs who are looking to work their way up and continue to play a bigger and better game. Mm-hmm. So on the 12-goal level, there's a very select few teams within the Chicagoland area. Us, Las Brisas, Passion for Polo, Beaver Creek, Morgan Creek, just to name a few, that continue to play together. We do have out-of-state teams that come on regular play, whether that be from Iowa, Milwaukee, St. Louis, and even as far south as Texas, and even as far east as Santa Barbara, California. That might come in and visit and play with us. So we have you know, Oakbrook, while it has its matches, it is affiliated with the tournament that is going around that particular week, whether it be the Oakbrook Polo Open, the Butler Challenge Cup. Right now, we're playing the Chicago Polo Open right now, followed by the Drake Challenge Cup and then the Butler International Cup. So those are going on kind of behind the scenes. You don't hear much that's going on. They're typically at private fields, so the general public usually can't attend. You know, when I say private fields, these are literally a large plot of land that is literally behind someone's house.
Yeah. One of the things I've always been curious about is the origin of a lot of the pro players. It seems like there's a disproportionate number of them that come from South America. Mm-hmm. What is the origin and the story behind that? Is it just by chance? Is polo looked at very differently down there? Is it a unique set of skills that are provided? I mean, what's the reasoning behind that?
You know, that's a really good question. I don't think I've ever been asked in terms of the origin of why polo is as big as it is in Argentina, which is where it's literally the most second popular sport.
You know, you go to I think of like the gauchos and yes, kind of that aspect of the culture. And that's kind of what I was thinking, but I wasn't sure.
You know, I think it probably, it has something to do with the number, you know, I think someone has to correct me if I'm wrong on this, but you know, there's a
sounds large like a topic for your podcast,
horses and farming and things like that, that sure, are in the Argentine area. Mm-hmm. And because of those horses and the accessibility of them, you know, the frequency of polo is very, very high. So mm-hmm, a lot of youth and individuals, you know, just like, you know, us in hockey or soccer, mm-hmm, you know, up here in the United States, they have that accessibility to ponies and the ability to ride very, very easily down here compared to how it is up here in the U.S. You know, it's much more difficult. It's much more expensive, where it's not like that down there. So you have kids that are starting out on a pony as young as 3 years old, wow, you know, picking up a mallet. It's crazy. So that's why you see a lot of professionals in here in the United States that have are Argentine. Sure. At the end of the day. So, you know, the three professionals on Oakbrook Polo's team, are all three of them are Argentine. You know, they have dual citizenship. Mm-hmm. But yeah, they're all from, you know, Buenos Aires or Palermo. At the end of the day, that's where they're born and raised, and you know, they come from polo dynasty families such as the Obregons and the Anados and the Gutierrez. So they have brothers, sisters, cousins, and so on and so forth that play the game. So it's really interesting.
It adds the global aspect to the sport, which is kind of cool. Exactly. At the end of the day.
Yeah, and you look at some of the families that are in there. I mean, it's generation after generation after generation of polo players. And you know, once one is kind of hooked into it, begins to own their own horses and might have a farm and so on and so forth on the side, you know, it just snowballs into mm-hmm, their other families getting involved in it. And if you're an individual who, you know, loves to be out the stores and is a bit of an adrenaline junkie and has fallen in love with horses and nature, it's the right sport for you. It really is. you know, I started riding as early as 10 years old. And I tell people, if polo was introduced to me at a much younger age, I would have been hooked. You know, because there is that adrenaline team aspect side to the game that is very, very attractive. So that's why you see people who might start in their 30s, for example, you know, once you have kind of the discretionary income to play the game, mm-hmm, you're seeing a lot of guys that had either played you know, football, rugby, you know, people who like do heliskiing and mm-hmm, things like that, that have a little bit of a screw loose, I always say. this is the game for them. And trust me, once you get on it and you're galloping alongside other people and they're on a horse and you're on a 900-pound animal swinging a mallet and getting a ball into your goal, it's a feeling that, you know, is very difficult to describe.
Well, it's interesting because I would agree with that. That's one of the things that I think threw me off. Well, not threw me off, but I was pleasantly surprised by. I mean, I grew up, as I said, on the East Coast. So, you know, you grow up playing lacrosse, you grow up playing heavy contact sports. And I was amazed at, and I don't, you know, in rugby, we would call it a scrum, but when all the horses come together, it's almost like a scrum where it's full contact. I mean, the horses are contacting each other. The players are contacting each other. You've got a pretty hard ball on the ground. You've got these long wooden mallets. I mean, you've got the two referees trying to keep some semblance of order. It's not a just kind of no contact sport. It is heavy, heavy contact. So with that, there has to be that component of adrenaline that really fuels the excitement.
And I can only imagine what the guys who play at at the professional level feel in this game. I mean, the connection that they have between themselves and the horse is a pretty phenomenal experience. You know, as an amateur player, feeling it is quite amazing in itself. But at that level, the horses are much more talented, much more skilled, have a great sense of the game where, you know, they are doing a lot of the work. You know, you ask a lot of pros, you know, a lot of it comes down to their string of horses where, you know, the horse itself is doing 75%, 80% of the work at the end of the day. And to have that experience where, you know, a ball is hit, the horse immediately knows to go after that ball. You know, I've seen pictures and I love the photography around the sport. You know, if there's anything that is beautiful and masculine and dangerous, it's the sport of polo.
Well, and your social media team does an amazing job. I mean, if you want to get a sense for what this is like, check out the Insta feed for Oakbrook Polo Club. I mean, the shots that they get, the high speed shots. I mean, there was a shot yesterday, I think, that was on your page of your number three player. I believe was it Obregon, I believe, at full speed. I mean, swinging the mallet, you could see just the strength of the horse. I mean, it's just, it's breathtaking to look at.
Muscles popping out of their skin and everything.
Yeah, I mean, it's the peak conditioning of these horses. And that's in 95 degree heat.
Yeah, there's a picture that was taken in it. It's actually one of my favorites because it's two horses that are going head to head with one another. And the players obviously are doing their thing. And you can see one of the horses looking back at the other horse. And
they know.
they know. They absolutely know. There is an intelligence that you don't normally see in these horses, and they have a personality all of their own, and they know the game. Wow. And just that horse looking next to it as the riders are either playing offense or defense of each other is pretty spectacular. Wow. You know, it's so small, little, tiny, finite details in the game that you don't normally see from the sidelines. But when you slow it down or take a photo of it to really capture the intensity and how majestic the game is, it's pretty cool. And when people describe it, you know, to me, I use the word majestic a lot to describe the game. And in my opinion, and having been in sports and have done everything from motor racing to collegiate to badminton, no other sport can you actually put majestic into its definition alongside adrenaline, danger, you know, any of that. You can't. It's the only sport. I've tried to categorize other games that are like that, and you can't. I mean, it's...
Yeah, the only thing I could probably, like, that sort of speed is, as I mentioned, I'm a big motorsports guy, so, like, the start of an F1 race is kind of what it's like when the horses come together. Mm-hmm. That just... pure pandemonium, and then everything kind of levels out a little bit. But just that, I mean, these horses coming together, the guys are 6-7 feet off the ground, and it's just it is majestic. I think you're right. One of the other things that I have found really enjoyable is watching a polo match, the experiential component of it, It's you're not just sitting in the stands watching. I mean, you can sit in the grandstands. You've recently opened the grandstands out in Oakbrook Polo Club, which is great. But a lot of it is the tailgating. And when I say tailgating, I don't think the listener should think of like the tailgating we do before a Bears game. The tailgating and that experience is very different. And I'm curious to get your perspective on why that is and what role that plays in the elevation of polo and its longevity.
Is it like specific to tailgating or?
Yeah, I mean, just it's Listen, when I go to polo, I dress up. Like, yeah. You know, the ladies dress up. They're in heels. I mean, and you wouldn't think that you would wear heels to an outdoor event. You know, big hats. Everybody, mm-hmm. you know, I very intentionally wash my car before I go to polo.
Yeah.
You know, the elaborate displays that people set up for their tailgate. This isn't, you know, throw a barbecue grill down, throw some burgers and, you know, a crock pot of chili down. Mm-hmm. It's very different, but I think that is a part of the polo experience.
It is. And tailgating, yes, you're right. Not to be confused with what you would do normally before a collegiate football game or a mm-hmm. Bears game and doing in a parking lot and,
yeah.
you know, doing shotguns of beer.
Yeah, I mean, I went to UNLV. A UNLV tailgate is nothing like.
Yeah. And we get questions like that. I seriously get calls like that all the time. People ask, like, all right, you know, if I get tailgating, then where do we go to watch the match? And I'm like, you walk from your tailgate spot. And so people are really confused. Even when we were, you know, last year during COVID, when we got approved by the state to have spectators, it took a while to educate state officials and health officials what tailgating was at polo. Mm-hmm. They had this preconceived perception that it was like a Bears game. Mm-hmm. And it was all of a sudden they had an aha moment like, oh, that's where people are watching from and you can spread them out. Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. You're approved. you know, 95% of the polo clubs that you go to in the United States, they are majority of them are exclusively tailgating where you're rolling up pickup truck, Bentley, doesn't matter, popping your trunk open, putting out tables and chairs, you know, sucking down, you know, champagne and what have you. Or to be honest with you, if you're a polo player, you're not a champagne person. You're sucking down Modelos and, you know, Coronas
sure.
at the end of the day. And, you know, having a picnic and running around and just taking in the beauty of outdoors and watching something as majestic and dangerous as polo. Mm-hmm. From the comforts of your car. And it happens all over the United States in some of the most beautiful areas. You know, some of the most beautiful places I've watched polo have to be in like Aspen and in Wyoming.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard about the Aspen. I've heard about the Aspen polo experience and it sounds legendary.
Yeah.
In the snow. I mean,
that's the Gansey.
I want to pick your brain on that a little bit. Yeah. That just sounds like a really cool experience.
And so there's just unbelievable places to do it. And that's how it's done. You know, when we go out and watch matches, you know, during the week, for example, you know, on some of the other clubs, you know, they're just kind of blocked off to the public. That's how it is. You know, I roll up my car, I pop the hook, you know, the back and, you know, bring myself a picnic. My kids run around and, you know, have a cerveza or two and just really enjoy myself in the sun, get a tan and, you know, watch some great polo. It's very relaxing and, you know, tranquil. There's something about it. Tailgating and polo go just hand in hand. I mean, you look at really old black and white photos and it goes all the way back, I swear, since the first Model T rolled off the assembly mm-hmm. line. And you just see all that, you know, up and down the sidelines of black and white photos, even here, you know, in Chicago when, you know, polo was played at Wencia, which was a popular polo club back in the day. That's how it looked, you know, on the sidelines until it became so popular that you had to install grandstands and things like that. So then Oakbrook Polo, when they came around, huge wooden grandstands where they're averaging 2,000 people per match.
Yeah.
You know,
this is also a way, though, for you as the managing director, and we can kind of maybe pivot into some of your other experience in sport and entertainment. This is also a way for you to really establish good corporate partnerships. Mm-hmm. So, you know, individuals that are thinking about majoring in sports management or going into this as their career, maybe not even polo necessarily, just sport in general, you know, the role of that corporate partnership is so key to the success of something like your polo club.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, corporate sponsorship is really critical to our success. You know, it helps subsidize our season and it helps, you know, our partners really get involved in the game from both an operational side is also what we can do for their brand and how they engage with our spectators and to drive business their way. Or, you know, letting people know that, hey, you know, they're here, they're a local business within, Chicago, or they're launching a new brand or product or what have you. And polo and that demographic is the right fit. Mm-hmm. You know, our demographics, you know, primarily are between 35 and 45 years of age. It's a sweet spot. You know, it's those young people who are established in their career, their new home buyers, their young families, they have discretionary income and so on and so forth. In my opinion, I am really surprised that more blue chip brands don't get involved in the sport. It is a very intimate and engaging environment. There are long afternoons. There's a lot of touch points. Our demographic is very keen on, you know, the luxury life, travel, shopping,
spending the discretionary income.
Yeah. You know, financial awareness and management and, you know, up, you know, all along the line. You know, in my opinion, yeah, you see the Bentleys and Ferraris and Lamborghinis out there in the world. Yeah. And that's great. You know, you're definitely going to have that very, very high net worth individual. But majority of the time, the people who are showing up at is people who are driving Audis and BMWs.
Sure.
You know, I look back at the last match and I swear I counted probably 30 Audis that came through. And it's like, how is that brand not involved in the sport? You know, it's...
Yeah. It's interesting because, you know, one of the reasons that we decided to become a strategic partner is... A cursory review of kind of your existing partners, we saw a lot of the similar brands that we partner with as well. And a lot of those were focused on hospitality and tourism. Whether they're our friends at Gibson's or beverage distributors or whomever it might be, you know, there's a natural connection there. And I think this really speaks to what we talk a lot about on the podcast about the hospitality and tourism industry isn't just, you know, working at the front desk of a hotel or being a server in a restaurant. It is so much more about that. And the connection between sports and entertainment, which has really been the focus of you and your career, is integral. I mean, they go hand in hand. And I think a lot of people have a misconception that they say, well, you know, I'm not really going to be involved in hospitality and tourism, but just by their nature, sporting events are hospitality centric. There's so much of that.
And at the end of the day, they're all forms of entertainment. And they're entertaining that individual, and you need to engage that individual and make them happy and to make sure that their experience is memorable at the end of the day. You know, when me and Jim Drury, the president of Oakbrook Polo, had set out to do this, we wanted to create a brand that had the right balance between the game itself, so the product on the field, and the experience that our people having. Too often, you know, when people come to, we've seen this happen all over the place. You know, polo brings a level of nostalgia where it's the pretty woman, it's the royal family, all that kind of thing. Just very common stereotypes, all right? Which is great. We don't have to resell those stereotypes. Those are things that just kind of come natural with the sport. But we feel as though people are not engaged in the sport. They're so often tied to the popping of champagne and the best hat and things like that, which are great. But at the end of the day, we want you to watch our game, no different than when you come to go to a Bears game or a Cubs game and what have you. You know, we want you to cheer on. We want you to be in awe of the game and the athleticism that goes into it. And nothing gets me more excited than when, you know, I'm sitting back behind the grandstands having a nice, you know, coffee to take a break, and I hear the crowd erupt when something on the field is taking place.
Sure.
I've done my job when I hear that.
Yeah.
Because people are so in tuned and engaged with the product of the field while having a good time. That is the right balance that you want to have. Sure. I've been to polo matches where 90%, Nick, of the people who are attending are not watching the game.
Yeah.
There's no engagement. No one knows anything about what's going on. They're more interested in just the party atmosphere, which doesn't do anything for our sport. You know, our sport is definitely not recession proof. We fight to get new students and players, and developing those players takes years to do. And we have to continue to keep those people on a hook and to engage them to continue to play in sport. It's a really hard thing to do.
And that's one of the reasons, is that one of the reasons that at a lot of the matches, and we'll kind of pivot to your career in a moment, but is that kind of one of the reasons you really promote the development of future polo players? You know, a lot of the advertisements, but a lot of the announcements that come out are about, you know, Polo University or being able to just teach people. And you're very, very specific when you say you don't have to have previous experience playing polo to learn. Like you don't have to have, you know, be a key sponsor of a polo club to get involved. That
All you
got to do is have an interest.
Yes, exactly. And again, it's one of those things where, you know, the common stereotype again, you know, and this is why we actually try not to use the word club in our name, mm-hmm. is that the word club usually means some type of membership or a certain status, if you will. And that is not true. I mean, you've seen our matches, Nick. I mean, the diversity and the level of entry at different price points is all over. Mm-hmm. So anyone from any background can come and really enjoy our game. And yes, it, you know, playing the game is expensive. It is. I'm not going to deny that. You know, if I were to, people always try to ask me, Dan, how you draw in comparisons in terms of the financial part. I always tell them, look, when you first get into the game, it's equivalent to hockey. But once you start getting and leasing and buying horses, it's equivalent to buying a yacht and having a boat. So if I can draw on those two, that's what it's like from a financial standpoint. But, you know, Oakbrook, we're really the facade of the Chicagoland overall polo community. So it has been a voice of the greater U.S. Polo Association and having Sunday, you know, public venues and public events that help feed the polo ecosystem with new players, patrons, and so on and so forth.
Sure.
And that's what we have to try to do. We have a vested interest in doing that. It's critical that we do it because we want to find the next generation of polo players to continue on because, you know, there's individuals who ultimately age out. You know, not everyone is like Jim Jury. Jim Jury is an ox for his age. Mm-hmm. You know, he's a silver fox that has incredible horsemanship and incredible athleticism for his age. And we could all wish that we're like that, you know, in our 70s and 80s and so on and so forth. And there's a couple guys out there that still are kicking it around. So it's incredibly impressive. And we have a really good youth environment, you know, around. We have a great women's community. So it's continuing to develop. You know, we've now produced two women that have won the back-to-back U.S. Polo Women's Championship. That's Dolores Nato, who is the daughter of Horacio Nato, who's on our team. And then you have Pamela Flanagan, who is originally from Barrington. She's an attorney. She lives in Colorado now. And she's a two-time U.S. Open Championship. So we're still producing them.
That's awesome.
Jared Zenny is another one. He's a 7-goal polo player. He's from the Lake Bluff area. There's still a polo field up there that's on private property, but you know, he got his start. He loved the game. He's a 7-goal professional polo player now. There's a great article about him in I forget what magazine it's Lake Bluff magazine that's up there. But it's amazing that we're still producing great talent coming out of Chicago. Yeah.
So speaking of kind of their start, going back through your CV, I'm so impressed about the multitude of things that you've been involved in. And a lot of them have focused on marketing. But throughout your career, one of the things that really struck me that I was really impressed by was the diversity of sport that you're involved in. And it seems like something that you really have embraced. And you went to University of Wisconsin at Madison, if I'm not mistaken.
Milwaukee.
Okay. Mm-hmm. You were an athlete there. Is sport something you knew that you wanted to go in for a career, or is it, you know, what kind of got you into that side of the business, or business for a better term, but you've just stuck with it for so long and it's been, it seems like a major part of your life.
Yeah, so I believe it or not, I was originally an architect major.
Okay.
One of the reasons why I went to Wisconsin-Milwaukee, they have a fine architecture school, and also ran track and field there. It wasn't until, you know, kind of getting a little bit better to know what it would took to get an architecture degree. You know, you had to get engineering degrees on top of that, you know.
The dreaded math classes.
which I'm fine with, you know. I'm a numbers guy at the end of the day. But I was introduced into the world of sports management, marketing, events, and so on and so forth from a relative of mine who continues to work specifically in the golf industry today. And he got me involved and I was hooked. And, you know, at that time, there wasn't any university that had a specialized department or school or classes or anything like that. I think maybe, you know, the University of Ohio maybe had it. Mm-hmm. That was probably the only one. So I had to create and carve a pathway for myself, which I did. And I've been very fortunate to have a great career having to work with, you know, International Management Group, with, you know, Mark McCormick, who is kind of the godfather of sports marketing today, mm-hmm. and athlete representation.
Well, IMG continues to just dominate. It continues to be one of the most recognized brands and
sold off and what have you, but it's still a huge player in the world of sports. I mean, mm-hmm. a lot of things can be credited and are rooted with that agency at the end of the day. And I'm very fortunate to have worked with a lot of their thought leaders there and gone on to then, you know, here in Chicago with Intersport and working alongside Charlie Besser, IEG Consultant, and working with Laren and Lisa Eukman, which was the you know, dominant force in the world of sponsorship consulting and measuring sponsorships and ROI against those investments. So working, you know, with those individuals was fantastic. And, you know, I look back at my career and yeah, it was really diverse, but my most memorable things in my career was working for the little guy or the more mm-hmm. unknown, you know, doing projects for NCAA, NFL, MLB, all of them. Yeah, that's great. But, you know, those are very overly saturated sports. Sure. That are highly commercialized. And I got the most satisfaction working for, you know, England badminton, you know, this is the smaller people. They don't hardly have any a budget. They're scrambling to put things together, making things work. They're highly passionate individuals who wear a lot of different hats. And that's what I was more attracted to. You know, when I was with IEG, I dealt with a lot of international sports that you would not find popular here today at all.
Well, it kind of speaks to why people maybe in hospitality go to work for some of the smaller brands that, you know, the Marriott, Hilton, and Hyatts of the world are great. They're fantastic companies. We don't disparage them. But sometimes being an entrepreneur or going to work for a small little independent owned and operated resort or restaurant can be equally as rewarding.
Yes. And I find them, you know, there's a lot less red tape, you know, corporate red tape. You know, they're more likely to take on risks, you know, really blow up a very unique, creative, and totally outside the box idea, where you're not beholden to brand and commercial and all of that, these restrictions that some of these major companies or organizations have. And that was a lot of fun doing it. And that was what actually attracted me to Polo, because Polo, you know, the USPA, you know, they're looking to expand and get into sponsorship and better market themselves. And, you know, they own the US Polo ASSN clothing brand, which, you know, is where the governing body is funded from. You know, they don't have to really do any sort of fundraising events or anything like that with major donors. That's where they're getting their royalties from. And, so they have the money to do so.
Sure.
And they put themselves on NBC. I think it's now CBS Sports. Mm-hmm. And, you know, at that time, they were looking to expand, and I put my hat in the ring. You know, I was young at that time, didn't have any kids, you know, continue to take on risks. And I worked as one of the head of marketing and partnerships for the governing body for 2 years remotely out of Chicago. Was it hard? Yes. Was it challenging? Absolutely. But
it seems like also a big part of that, of what you've gained personal and professional satisfaction is the philanthropic side of it too. A lot of things that you've been involved in have done that, or have been in that realm as well. And there seems to be a nice synergy between sporting and philanthropic efforts.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I mean, it's like golf. You know, golf has a very philanthropic connection. You know, you always see golf outings and so on and so forth, helping out an individual or a cause at the end of the day. Wow, does Polo raise a lot of money?
I can imagine.
There's no question about it. Some, you know, what a 4-hour event can bring in sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just a lot of people with deep pockets and you know, you could pull on those heartstrings and there you go. I mean, I want to say, you know, since 2016, you know, for as small as we are, we probably raised $500,000 for
That's great.
You know, across all different types of organizations, from Paws Chicago to Friends of Conservation and the conservation efforts in Africa. And
yeah, I mean, the matches that I've been to, you're right. I mean, Paws Chicago was there, and there was a, and I don't remember the name of the organization. You can probably help me out, but an organization that was really equine therapy.
Yeah.
So we're right. really involved in kind of using the equestrian side of animals to help recuperate.
People. Correct. Yeah. Whether it be physical or mental, and physical, mental, special needs. You know, there's an organization called Brave Hearts, which specializes with veterans and PTSD. And it's amazing what horses can do to help as part of therapy with those individuals who are suffering from those things. And it's great. There's a lot of organizations that are out there that do that. So for big props to RET and Brave Hearts, who we've worked with in the past. Yeah.
So as we kind of wrap up, Danny, if someone's listening to this and you threw out the line with the hook on the end of it and you've got a nibble and they want to go to their first polo event at Oakbrook, what are they doing? Are they just going onto the website, buying a ticket? You've still got some matches coming up this season. Mm-hmm. Next year will be your 100th anniversary.
Yes.
Matches are on Sundays at 3:00. They can just go and buy tickets and they should feel free to do so.
Yeah, I mean, go to our website, oakbrookpoloclub.com. All the information is there in terms of the types of tickets, our schedule, even kind of, you know, the spectator guidelines to help prep or get yourself mind and, you know, body right for what to prepare for a polo match. We're happy to answer any questions, no matter how ridiculous they are, to help you get situated for your first polo match. But I will tell you one thing, once you do, you will be hooked.
You'll be hooked and you'll make a ton of new friends.
Yeah.
And the moment you get there, you will see that Oakbrook, but I think polo in general really embodies the hospitality spirit. And that's what we try to convey to people, on the podcast and you're a living embodiment of it. Everything that you do on those Sundays.
Yes. No question about it. I mean, you're going to be hooked and we're going to see you at a lot more matches and it's probably by far, in my opinion, one of the best group outings you can have with friends, family, colleagues. If you're entertaining clients, it is a truly memorable experience. And if you're looking to do something, you know, completely out of the norm than your typical, box seats at a Cubs game sort of thing, this is mm-hmm. it. It really, really is. I mean, we have corporate groups, individuals who constantly come back year after year after year and absolutely love it.
That's fantastic.
So, I really encourage it. I mean, I have my own colleagues from other sports, mainstream sports that come out here that get hooked and are just most amazed. And they try to figure out how is this game not more popular in today's world. So I'm still in it. You know, they haven't let me go. So it's created a nice, lifestyle and, environment for me at the end of the day. So,
sure.
It's allowed me to do some incredible things and I'm still doing things at the end of the day with my company to, you know, enhance the sport and bring it into the 21st century and get more eyeballs on the game. Because I sincerely believe that, it has not nearly scratched the surface of the type of visibility and respect the game deserves.
Well, Danny, you are a sports and entertainment marketing trailblazer, brand architect, entrepreneur, business strategist. One of the many hats you wear is the managing director of the Oakbrook Polo Club. I can't thank you enough for being a guest on the Hospitality Spirit today.
Happy to be here, Nick. Thank you.
Thank you.